Let me share this word with you. You know, we're in a season where the Lord was just speaking to my heart as we're worshiping. Now, this is a season of giving birth. And what that means is that many of God's people are giving birth to new things. You know, when you have a newborn baby, something new has come into your life. And so there's a birthing of new things for many in the body of Christ. I'm not just talking about this church, but in the body itself, the church as a whole. There is a birthing of new things. We're living in exciting times. Some of us, our trials has been giving birth to something new. For some of us, it's a birthing of a new attitude, a new spirit. This season, for many, it'll be a birthing of a new ministry. And it doesn't matter if you've been in ministry for a long time, there's a change. There's a shift to something new. For some, it's a new career. It's just birthing into something new. And so there's a lot of movements. I really believe that, like in the book of Acts, it's a book of movements. We're in a season of great movements in the body of Christ. And so, you know, as Johnny was speaking this morning about the promises of God, it's a birthing of something new for God's people. But I want to encourage everyone here this morning, no matter what God is birthing in your life, whatever new thing, listen, how many believe that even relationships can become new? There could be a birthing of new relationships. Come on. A restoration and into something that is new. But in the promised land, there was a shift to warfare. It was a different season from the wilderness where God's people were being tried. They were being tested. And there was a level of growth and maturity that needs to come forth in the wilderness. Somebody say amen. You know, I heard the Lord speak to me this morning as we're worshiping. He said, the enemy cannot stop our gifts, but he could damage our character. He could damage our integrity. He could damage our spirit and our hearts. He could cause flaws, things that would cause us to fall character-wise. That's the reason why we see people, gifted people, continue to be gifted, continue to operate in their giftings. But their character is where the enemy would like to attack. And so in the promised land, we are to not only past the wilderness, but when we get into the promised land, we're supposed to war now for the new season, for the new birthing of whatever God's birthing in our lives. I don't know if anybody feels that in this season. I feel this new thing coming. A lot of new things for God's people. But we're going to enter in not just with prayer or worship, but we need to add the warfare now. Come on. For the new thing that you're going into. Come on. Now I know we just, you know, your pastor just moved into a new house, and this whole transition, God's been speaking to me about this thing. We're moving into something. God is getting ready to move upon God's people. And I've been hearing the Lord speak to me all morning while we're here just worshiping in just a short, brief time, that we need to become more aggressive in our kindness, in our goodness, in our generosity. This is the time to be aggressive. I heard this word, Jesus said this word. He said, the kingdom suffereth violence, but the violent takes it by force. And you know what? Love needs to become more violent, more aggressive, right? We need to, like, love with each other with incredible passion. Amen. And so as we move in this area, as we just, so many changes going on in the body. It's just, I'm telling the Lord, I said, there's so much things are going on. And the Lord said, there's incredible amount of grace poured out in this season upon my people. It's just incredible amount of grace, just layers of grace. And so whatever you move into, be aggressive in your love for God and in the love for where you are going. Be aggressive in your generosity where you're going. Be aggressive in your kindness and where you're going. Be aggressive in your forgiveness where you're going. Be aggressive in your blessing where you're going. You're going something. You're going somewhere because there's a birthing of new things in our lives. Some families, it's a massive change. It's something new happening in your whole family. Career-wise, massive change. You're going into something new. And you're going to learn to prosper there. And God begins to bless. Amen. What an incredible season that we're in. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you, Lord, that the Holy One is leading us out into new places, birthing of new things in our lives. You know, when it comes to birthing, sometimes we think it's just ministry, but it could be the birthing of so many things. And we just don't recognize what God is birthing in our lives. You know, some of us, our heart is changing and with a different attitude. That's a birthing. Some of you, you're coming out of a place where it was difficult before, but now it's getting easier. You're becoming something new. That's a birthing of the new you coming out, coming forth. Come on. Some of us who had, you know, bad mouths and now you're seeing changes where you don't speak like you used to yesterday. There's a birthing of something new. Your spirit is changing. A season of birthing of so many things. Lord, I pray this morning for your people. I really believe, Lord, that you have some awesome things in store for us in this season. And so, Father, we pray against anything. Anything, Lord God, that would delay and prevent these promises to manifest in this season. These promises that are ordained for us in this season to prosper and to bless your people in new ways. Lord, that you remove every obstacle, remove every Jericho wall in Jesus' name. Let there be a new breakthrough in every way in the name of Jesus. We just thank you for it. We just receive it now, and I just want you to just receive it by faith. Just to say, Lord, I thank you for the new thing this morning. I thank you for the new thing this season. And thank you for the new thing you're doing in my heart. A new thing you're doing in my marriage. A new thing you're doing in my family. A new thing you're doing in the ministry. New things you're doing in my career. New things that you're doing. I thank you for it, Lord. And I thank you, Lord, that you're putting wings on this new thing. So that this new thing begins to fly, begins to lift, and begins to move in the name of Jesus. Listen, we need some divine wings. For some of you, you're going to think that this thing is going to be difficult to get off the ground. But listen, put wings to it. Ask God to put some wings to it. Lift it. Lord, lift this new thing. Begin to lift it and begin to move it in Jesus' name. And we just thank you, Lord. We just receive it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Come on, we can give the Lord a good shout now. Amen. Give the Lord a good shout. Greet someone before you take a seat. Move around. Welcome someone to the house of the Lord this morning. Amen. Well, this morning, we don't need no introduction because he is a man of God who's blessed us many times. But I want us to do this one thing. Let's stand up. Let's receive Pastor Anthony. He's going to bring the Word of God this morning. Let's just honor the man of God as he brings the heart of God and the Word of God to us this morning. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's give him another nice hand as he comes.
It's good to be here with you guys. It's good to see all of your smiles. And we're just going to have a great time today. Amen. I'm going to let my wife just greet you, and then we're going to just stand up together, and then she's going to pray for this service today, okay? And I believe that that we're going to have just a great time. You guys don't have to stand up yet. Don't have to stand up yet. Let me let her greet you first, okay? I don't want you standing that long.
I think everyone knows me, so hello. I think I've already greeted all of you once. Good morning. It's always a pleasure to be in the house of the Lord and here at Ezekiel 37. This is home. This is, it's just comfortable. Thank you again, Pastor Kimo and Auntie Joss for inviting us and allowing us to be ministered to and to minister. Again, I hope you all understand how much we honor Pastor Kimo. Without him, we would not be who we are today. Taking us from young people who are just needed Jesus. We just needed Jesus. We had issues. We were young, and we just didn't know what we were doing in life. And Pastor Kimo and Auntie Josh just mentored us, believed in us, loved on us, and I'm sure you all can agree with that. Can you give Pastor Kimo a hand? You know, gracious. They are so gracious. And so we are very thankful to be here today. And this morning I was praying and I was asking the Lord, you know, Lord, you know, what do you want me to share? You know, what do you want me to say this morning? And you know, God is awesome. We were just having a conversation together and he said, you know what? I never yell. And I said, okay. And I began to look, and, you know, Scripture, you never hear that God shouts. God never yells. It always says he speaks. And if anything, many times we hear that you can hear God in a whisper. And I began to ask the Lord, well, what does that mean? And he said, well, I'm not like humans. He said, when you guys raise your voice, it's because you feel you're not being heard or you're not being understood. He says, you shout for victory. I already have it. I don't need to shout for victory. He said, you know, you shout to get attention. He goes, I don't need to. I know who I am. And I said, okay, God. I said, so, you know, what do we do with that? And he says, the thing is, you just don't listen. And he brought back to mind, you know, who's a parent? How many times you talk, like, literally right next to your child, you have eye contact and everything, and then after you finish speaking, they ask you the exact same question about what you said, and you're like, didn't I just say this? And you said, you're not listening. And that's what God said. He said, sometimes you're just right next to me, and I'm talking to you, and you're just not listening. So that's what I'm going to pray this morning, that, you know, God opens our ears, that we have an attentive ear so that we're listening to what God is saying, and not just listening, but that we have understanding in our heart. Because sometimes we hear things, but we don't really grasp what it means. And so we don't need God to yell. We just need to listen. Okay, so if you would stand up and bow your heads, and we're just going to enter in. Lord God, I just thank you so much, Lord God, for the awesome privilege of being here today, Lord God. And Lord, I thank you for your word. And I thank you that you are here, Lord. You are present. And you want to do a mighty work within our lives. So, Lord, we just give you our minds right now. And I pray, Lord God, that we would be able to hear your voice, that we would clearly be able to hear, Lord God, the words that you are trying to speak to our hearts, Lord. Lord, let us have open hearts that can receive what you are saying, Lord God. For, Lord, you are not one who condemns us, Lord God, but you encourage us and you breathe life into us. So I pray, Lord God, that we would be able to filter out any negativity that is coming our way from the enemy and clearly hear what your word has to say to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, babe. Would you remain standing this morning as we get into the word here? We're going to have, I think, just a great time because I done gone through hell to be here this week. I'm just going to be honest with you. There's just been a lot of things happening, and I really received that word that Pastor Kimo released. It's really just birth pains. It's things that are beginning to start new. And, you know, women who have had babies, you're not smiling when you're having a baby, right? I don't think there's any woman that's like, yep, the baby's coming. They're screaming and they're in pain and it's ugly. It gets ugly up in there. I almost threw up, but anyway. Sometimes you have to go through the ugly stuff before you see something new, right? Amen. Open up with your script, your Bibles with me here today. 2 Kings chapter 6. 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 1 through 7. And when you have it, say amen. And if you don't, say, oh man, it's right behind you, should be right behind you. And the word says, now the sons of the prophet said to Elisha, see, the place where we dwell under your charge is too small for us. Say, too small for us. Let us go to the Jordan and each of us get there a log, and let us make a place for us to dwell there. And he said, go. Then one of them said, be pleased to go with your servants. And he answered, I will go. So he went with them. And when they came to the Jordan, they cut down trees. But as one was felling a log, his axe head fell into the water. And he cried out, alas, my master, it was borrowed. Then the man of God said, where did it fall? And when he showed him the place where he cut off a stick and threw it in there and made the iron float. And he said, take it up. So we reached out his hand and took it. Look at your neighbor and say, take it. And you may go ahead and have your seats this morning. Do we have any runners in the house today? Anybody run? Anybody run? I know Mike runs because I see him on Instagram talking about, I just ran 13 miles and stuff. And I'm just like, dude, I can't even run 1 mile. But anybody's ever run in the past? Like any races? Anybody race? You did a race. Okay. Let me ask you this. How many miles are in a 5K? Does anybody know? How many miles are in a 5K? Anybody know? No? It is 3.1 miles. Anybody know how many miles are in a 10K? This is a trick question. 6.2. That was easy, right? You just double it. How many miles are in a 10-mile race? Anybody? 10. Okay, so you caught that. Good, 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 good. How many miles are in a marathon? Does anybody know how many miles are in a marathon? 26.2. Have you ever run a marathon? Not quite halfway there? No. A marathon is 26.2 miles. You're almost to the Bay Area if you start from here. You're almost to the Bay Area. That's a lot, right? That's a lot. 26.2 miles. This reason why I'm sharing this with you is because there is a term that they talk about when it comes to running a race, in particular a marathon, and it is called the wall. And the wall is the place where your mind and your body simultaneously want to give up. In fact, one person puts it like this, that every year, hundreds and thousands of runners will have the opportunity to hit the wall. The wall is defined as the period in a marathon when things transition from pretty hard to really, really hard. It is the point where your body and mind are simultaneously tested. It is the perfect intersection of fatigue and diminished mental faculties. How many of you know that we all hit the wall when it comes to life? Have you ever been there? We all hit the wall. We all hit the wall in our marriage. We all hit the wall in our home. Hopefully you're not making holes in the wall, but we all hit the wall. Moms will hit the wall. Dads will hit the wall. Children will hit the wall. Pastors will hit the wall. Leaders will hit the wall. Businesses will hit the wall. There are dreams that hit the wall. Ministries hit the wall. Are you getting what I'm saying? There is nobody that is immune to hitting the wall. You will all get to the place where your mind and your body simultaneously want to give it up. We all been there, right? Amen? It's just part of life. It's part of life. The wall is the most intense part of the race, because it is the decision point to continue or to quit. It is the exact point where all your pre-race plans go out the window. What motivated you at the beginning of the race no longer motivates you. The hope that you saw at the beginning of your marriage, you don't see that hope anymore. The time that you saw before you have kids, all of a sudden like, oh my God, what the devil got into my kids. It is the wall. It is the wall that is the defining point where you have to come to a decision. Do I continue or do I quit? Have you ever seen the place where something that was once easy is no longer easy anymore? Have you ever been to the landscape that you once dreamed of disappear and you ask yourself, where am I in life? Who am I in life? What is going on? Has anybody been there? If you have, say amen. How you handle the wall can literally make or break your marathon. I really believe today's message is going to stir you to break the wall down. I really believe that there are walls that we all go through with in different stages of our lives. And those walls are defining moments. They're more opportunities than they are opposition. You've got to be able to train your eyes to be able to see the opportunity in the opposition. And many times when we face a wall, it just feels like the walls are all caving in. And when the wall feels like it's caving in, it feels like there's no hope. The scripture today is a story about an axe head that comes off. In fact, it's the story that shows a picture of somebody hitting the wall. What's happening here is there's a school of prophets led by a man by the name of Elisha. It's kind of like a college, and there's a dorm, and everybody lives in the dorm. And they began to experience expansion and began to experience growth, and pretty much what happens is they say, hey, this place is getting too small. We got to move out of here. We need to build. And so they come together, and they say, okay, well, let's go and let's build. But if we're going to build, then we're going to have to go and we're going to have to build by cutting down trees and preparing the logs so that we can build a structure, a building, a house, whatever you have it. So they go and they start to build. And as they're cutting down the trees, now this is not a hatchet. This is my tactical, an axe. It's a tactical hatchet. I like tactical stuff. Don't laugh because it's kind of small. But it's fun to play with. Kids, don't play with these. So this guy is in the forest. And the Bible says that as he was felling a log, that the axe head flew off. The Bible doesn't say how long these men were out in the woods, doesn't say how many trees they cut down. All we know are two things. One thing that is mentioned and the other is not, is that the axe was borrowed, and here's what's not mentioned. The head had become loose because the edge was ignored. How many of you know that if you go to the store and you buy a hatchet or an axe, it doesn't come with a loose head? Over time, as you use it, the head of the axe, the edge, becomes dull. And the more you use it that way, the more you use the axe, what ends up happening is that you have to apply more effort to be able to get the job done. And then what happens is as you apply more effort And as this edge becomes more and more dull, what ends up happening is it begins to affect an area of the axe right here called the eye. And the eye is what's holding on to the axe head. And the more you use it, and the more you use it dull, and the more effort you apply, what ends up happening is the eye begins to let go of the axe head. And pretty soon, the axe head falls off. The edge of the axe does the work, but the eye keeps everything together. The edge of the axe was ignored. And whatever is ignored becomes dull. You see, this is the picture that many people find themselves in. If I can have Joel come here. And just stand right there in the middle of the box. There you go. We're in life. And we're chopping away. Maybe at the beginning of your life, you had dreams, you have ambitions, you have things that you want to see, things that you want to accomplish, and you're chopping at life. You're chopping at life in high school, or you're chopping at life going through college, or you're chopping at life to have a great family. You're chopping at life to have a great marriage. You're chopping at life, and you know you have kids. You're chopping away at life to have a business or to do ministry. You're chopping away at life, and things get busy, but you keep on chopping. Things get hard, but you keep on chopping, and the trees fall, and this falls, and that falls, and you're getting through life, but then all of a sudden what happens is that what you realize is, man, this tree seems like it's getting a little harder to chop. All of a sudden it feels like, man, are they getting stronger? Are they getting bigger? What's going on with the trees? You look at life and you're chopping away and you're chopping away and you're tired and you're frustrated and you're fatigued. And then all of a sudden you look and you're like, wait a minute, I thought I took care of that tree. I thought I took care of that tree. Where did this tree come from? Where did that tree come from? What am I going to do about this tree? And pretty soon what happens is you look at life and you find yourself in a box. Just like Joel. And you're chopping away. Don't swing by me. And you're chopping away. Go ahead, chop away. Don't chop the chair. And you're chopping away, and you're chopping away, and yet you still remain surrounded by the box. Can't get out. There's a wall that you're dealing with. And the wall's not falling because the edge of the axe is dull. And you think that putting more effort, maybe this wall will fall. And you think that putting more effort, more time working, more time paying attention to this thing, more time paying attention to that thing, more time, you know, doing Pilates or whatever you want to do. You spend all this time, you spend all this effort, you spend all this motivation and this drive and this energy, and then you don't see the results. Do you know how frustrating that becomes? Am I talking to anybody? Have you ever felt like God is not answering your prayer? I mean, have you ever been in that place where you feel like you're just boxed in? You're facing a wall and you're trying to cut away. You're trying to find the hope. You're trying to find the peace. But all you have is anxiety. All you have is discouragement. All you have is hopelessness. All you have is anger. And it's just this routine. Has anybody ever been there? And you're chopping away, and you're chopping away, and you're chopping away, and nothing is happening. Can I submit this to you? Often when nothing is happening is when the most is happening. Thanks, Joel. Give Joel a hand clap here. The more effort you put in, the less results you see. The more effort you put, the more frustration you find. The more effort you put, the less energy you have, the less joy you have, the less passion you have, the less hope you have. How come I'm not seeing the wall break down?
How come I'm not happy? How come I can't get past this problem? How come other people can do it, but I can't? Where am I? Who am I? How did I end up here? What am I going to do? And then you hit a wall. I mean, life is tough, isn't it? It's just tough. There's no YouTube channel that you can find that's going to help you get all the way through life. There's just not. Can I encourage you this morning? I mean, you can't find somebody's Instagram feed for Life 101 that's going to give you all the joy that you need. I only like Instagram for one thing, for the food. Because some people be taking them great pictures. I was talking about with Uncle Zane last night. We were looking at food and was just like, oh. And we had just eaten like an hour before. I only like it for food. Check this out. John chapter 15, verse 5. Don't worry, this axe head or this head is not loose. John chapter 15, verse 5, here's what Jesus said. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Key word there, you can do nothing. Apart from me, you can do nothing. I tried many times to do things without God. Sometimes knowing and then other times unknowing. I try to do things at times in my own effort, in my own understanding. I'm not going to stab myself here, so let me put this down. I've tried many times to try and figure things out with my own logic and my own reasoning. I tried many times to try to make sense of something and try to put it together with my own way. And often it's just chopping away and I'm not making any progress. And the reason why I'm not making any progress is because my edge is not sharp. The edge in your life is powered by God. The edge in your life is powered by the Holy Spirit. The edge in your life for your dream, for your hopes, for your marriage, for your family, for your children, for your business, for your ministry, whatever it is, the edge for your life is found in God and God alone. You can't do anything on your effort to make things work 100% all the time. It has to be God that is your edge. The wall, it secludes you. It boxes you in. It holds you back. And I'm here today to tell you that it's not about what is in front of you today. It's about what life looks like on the other side of the wall. Can you imagine just for a moment what maybe life looks like on the other side of what you're facing today? Can you imagine just for a moment? You may have an opposition of money that you owe or debt or some situation, a sickness or an illness or some type of problem or some type of situation in the home, a marriage, whatever it is. Can you imagine what life just for one moment looks like on the other side of that wall? Can you imagine the joy that God has for you? Can you imagine the prosperity that God has for you? Can you imagine the blessing that God has for you? Can you imagine what that looks like just for a moment? The happiness, the fulfillment, the joy, everything that comes along with serving God. The Bible says that apart from me, Jesus saying this, apart from me, you can't do anything. The flip side is with God. There is no impossibility. Show me an impossibility in the Bible that God could not conquer. He will choke slam that impossibility and slam it down on the ground like Mike does to people. The Bible says, look at this really quickly here. The Bible says, in the very first part, it says, see the place where we dwell? This is the school of prophets, the school
And they talked to Elisha and they said, see this place? It's too small for us. Somebody has to get frustrated and tired and straight up nasty and say, I'm sick and tired of living here. This place is too small for me. This place is too small for my home. This place is too small for my marriage. This place is too small for my dreams. This place is too small for my ministry. This place is too small for everything that God wants to do in my life. This place is too small. This place, I can't live here any longer. I can't do this anymore. I won't stick around and live in this place. This place has to break down. This place has to open up. This place has to be gone. And you can only do that when God becomes part of your life and gives you the ability and the strength, and he sharpens your edge, and all of a sudden the prayers that seemed like they weren't working began to happen like never before. All of a sudden what happens is the things that took long all of a sudden become expedited. Do you know that God can do more on his own than what you try for many years? God can take somebody, and you might see, you know what, I've dealt with this situation for 10, 15, 25 years, and you've been trying by your own effort, and you've been trying to chop your way out of it, and you've been trying in your own effort, and your own understanding, and your own way of doing things, and God says, wait a minute, what has taken you 20 years can take me 20 days. I can take you in a place that you cannot get to on your own, because when God is involved, you show me an impossibility that has ever stopped God. It just doesn't exist. It doesn't exist. Some of you need to understand that it's too small for you to dwell there. It's too small for you to dwell in the frustration. It's too small for you to live there. It's too small. You can't stay there. Some people die at the wall. They never get outside of the box. If there's anything that the enemy wants to do, is he wants to cage in people's lives. He wants to put a place in your life where there is hopelessness, where there is discouragement, where there is failure, where there is defeat. That's all the devil has for you. But the Bible tells me that God sees you and he sees a champion. And you want to know something great is that even though you may be in the box, he still says, that's a champion right there. Even though you may have failed, he says, you know what? That's a winner right there. Even though you may be surrounded and not know what to do, God is looking at you and he's saying, that is somebody that can still make it and I will not give up on them. That's what God does. That's what he does. His grace is amazing. His grace blows me away because even when I've doubted God, even when I've failed God, even when I've turned my back on my family, God says, you know what? That is somebody that I love and I love them unconditionally and I will not give up. I will keep going after him no matter what. God's grace is amazing. It's amazing. The axe head falls off. This is what many people find themselves in. Their edge is lost. And not only do they lose the edge, they lose the ability to not even sharpen it. The axe head falls off. How many of you know that iron doesn't float? Too many people are living with access blocked by their identity. It is who they think they are, not that is barricading their future. Where you are is too small for you. There is a person inside of you that is great. I don't care what you faced. I don't care how many times you messed up. I don't care what has gone on in your life. I don't care what's happened this week. There is a person inside of you that is destined for greatness. That is what God has created you to be. There's a person inside of you. Say person. You know that there is things that you can do in this life that nobody else can do quite like you. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm special.
There are things that you are dreaming about that unless you do not become the dream, then somebody else misses out on you showing up. Do you know that there is a place for you? There is a place. There's a scripture in the Bible where it talks about some money that's owed, and Jesus sends a disciple, and the disciple goes to the water, to the lake, and then he pulls out a fish. Jesus told him this: I want you to go to the water. I want you to pull out a fish, and when you open the fish's mouth, it's going to have a coin in it, and that coin is what you're going to use to pay the taxes. I mean, doesn't that talk about the perfect place at the right time? Do you know that many people are fighting frustration because they're not in the place that's supposed to be? And I'm not just talking about a physical place. I'm talking about a place in your thought life. I'm talking about a place in your heart. I'm talking about a place maybe even financially, or maybe even, wherever it is in your life that you have a tension about. Chances are you are not in the place that you're supposed to be. That destiny is literally calling you. Destiny is pulling you. You know that Jesus will mess your life up. He loves you so much. He loves you so much that he will literally let you get frustrated with destiny calling your name every single day. I mean, have you ever woken up or even gone to sleep thinking, there's got to be more? I mean, have you ever said that to yourself? Like, man, there's something of value of my life that I just can't figure it out, but I really feel like something is supposed to happen. Those are the questions that God probes in your heart by his Holy Spirit. There's got to be more. There's more. There's a place for you to arrive to. And unless you arrive, somebody else misses out. If Pastor Kimo had never been alive, where would my wife and I be? If he never became a youth pastor, if I never had the opportunity to sit under his teaching, if I never had the opportunity to hear him, to see how he operates, to see the love that exudes from his life, if I never had the opportunity, where would I be? He showed up at the right place at the right time. It was like the fish that had the coin in its mouth. It's a crazy moment. And all of you have that in your life. All of you have it. You have a place you have to show up to. And unless you show up, somebody misses out. There's a promise for you to live out. Everybody with a pair of hands, raise up your hand. All of you have a promise. Every single one of you. If you had your hand up, you have a promise. Blessing is a result of obedience, but promise is a result of endurance. It is that person that refuses to lose their edge that sees promise. It is that person that says, I feel low. I feel like I messed up. I feel disgusted with myself. I feel frustrated, but I got to sharpen up the edge. I blew it. I messed up. I yelled at my kids and I said something that I shouldn't have done. I got to sharpen the edge. I feel like quitting, God. I feel like nobody sees me. I'm so frustrated, God. I feel like I just want to end it all. God's saying, no, just sharpen your edge. Yeah, I feel like, God, that this business is just going to fail, and I feel like I just can't get past this place. I feel surrounded, and God's saying, just let me sharpen your edge. Let me bring my word into it. Let me bring the Holy Spirit into it. Let me illuminate your path. Let me give you some hope. Let me strengthen you, son. Let me strengthen you, daughter, and all of a sudden, you begin to see things change. But God has to be involved. When you discover the real you that God has destined you to become, the place that you are destined to be will make room for you.
We were watching BET the other day, the Music Awards. Remember? Remember, Auntie Belen? We were watching BET. And they had to try so hard. I was watching these ladies, right? And they're just like, they had to try so hard to make themselves look so good. It's just crazy. And I was just like, it just spoke to me. And it was just like, you know what? How many times do we do that? We try to make our own way, and we try to make things, and it's so hard. It becomes so easy when God has sharpened your edge, when God is involved. Doesn't become like A1 overnight, but eventually you get to the place where you become unstoppable. I want an unstoppable home. I really do. I want an unstoppable marriage. I want unstoppable children. I want an unstoppable business. I want an unstoppable, you know, anointing. I want to be unstoppable. How many want to be unstoppable? The person that becomes the person that they're supposed to be will walk and become in the place that they're supposed to inhabit. And they will live out a promise. And I call that living on the cutting edge. And any obstacle that you have can fall. Doesn't mean that life's going to be perfect. Doesn't mean that it's going to be A1 overnight. But the obstacle can fall. I love what Tommy Barnett says about quitting. Tommy Barnett is a pastor in Phoenix, Arizona, and he has this remarkable message about quitting. It's called The Honor of Wanting to Quit. Check this out. He says, wanting to quit is a sign of success. Because if you want to quit, it means that you have something to quit on. The more you have to quit, the more you want to quit. The higher you go, the more frightening it becomes. The lonelier it becomes. The riskier it becomes. You can enjoy the luxury of wanting to quit if you're not going to quit. One phrase he says is that it's okay to want to quit, just don't. I want to show you a video really quick here about a young man and his dad. He just absolutely refused to quit. Go ahead.
January 10th, 1962. We knew there was something wrong, but we did not know exactly what. The doctor said, forget Rick. Put him away, put him in an institution. He's going to be nothing but a vegetable for the rest of his life. We cried a little bit. We talked, and we said, no, we're not going to put Rick away. We're going to bring Rick home and bring him up like any other child. We knew Rick was smart. We could tell by looking in his eyes. And when we talked to him, he was paying attention to what we were saying. So we wanted to get a computer built so Rick could communicate with us. Everybody came to our house that night for Rick to say his first words. And everybody was betting, you know, what is the first words Rick is ever going to say? His mom saying, it's going to be, hi, Mom. And me, the dad, saying, oh, it's going to be, hi, Dad. Well, the Boston Bruins were going for the Stanley Cup, and the very first words Rick ever said was, go Bruins.
Dick is a military man, so he knows a thing or two about commitment. This time, he's just months removed from a heart attack. This gift that he gives to his son, or is it the other way around? Either way, it all started when Rick heard about a charity run for a paralyzed athlete. He asked Dad, and Dad said yes.
we went off with all the other runners, and everybody thought that Rick and I would just go to the corner and turn around and come back. Well, we didn't. We finished the whole 5 miles coming in next to last, but not last. And when we got home that night, Rick wrote on his computer, "Dad, when I'm running, it feels like my disability disappears." So that was a very powerful message to me, that we finally found a sport that Rook could get involved in just like everybody else. Rick is my motivator. He inspires me. To me, he's the one out there competing, and I'm just loaning him my arms and my legs so that he can compete. There's just something that gets into me when I'm out there competing with Rick that I can't explain it, and we're able to go faster. And it's just an unbelievable feeling. Rick and I love the Ironman triathlon. To be out there competing with the best triathletes in the world, to be accepted to compete along with these triathletes. Just to be out there on that pier with all the other triathletes and then waiting in the water for that cannon to go off, it was just so exciting. The feeling coming down the finish line at Leahy Drive, it's just an awesome experience. With the crowd there, all the excitement, the noise, and the announcers announcing all that, the adrenaline just gets flowing. One more time for Nick. Here he is. He graduated from public high school. He's graduated from college. He's out there competing in road races and triathlons. He lives a happier life probably than 95% of the population. Rick would tell you that, if he was physically able to do something, that he'd probably play basketball or football or hockey. But then he always says, no, the first thing he'd do is sit down, have me sit down in his wheelchair and he'd push me. You know, it really makes me feel good that he appreciates, what I'm trying to do to help him out, and he'd do the same thing for me. Our message is, yes, you can. You can do anything you want to do as long as you make up your mind. You can do it.
If you have ever searched for the meaning of life, stop. The answer lies right here. By the way, Ricky would want us to tell you, the Bruins look pretty good this year.
Uncle Zane. Zane, can you help me out? Did you catch the part that said, the son asked, and the father said yes? The scripture today says that the man who lost his edge, lost his axe head, cried out to the man of God. And the man of God said yes. I believe that God is not just saying yes to you today, but he's also saying the next line, which is, reach out, take it. Some of you need to grab the axe again. And you need to start swinging. But you have to have the effort, becoming God's and not your own. This story is remarkable because the iron floated. One version says that the iron floated and came back together with the piece of wood. That's crazy. Most times when life gets extremely difficult, it's just the opportunity for God to work in your life. I've seen it time and time again, where people become so hopeless, and all of a sudden, God does something that you never thought could happen. The axe floats, comes back together, and lives are changed. We had an axe head moment. I was just sharing with Pastor Kimo over dinner last night. My grandmother had a fall. And when she had a fall, she broke her arm. And they said that the arm was like melted ice cream, like an ice cream sandwich. It was just moving like crazy. My grandmother is in her 90s, and she has Parkinson's. And so she shakes a lot. And the arm that she broke was her right arm, her right arm. And so she has really not very much control over the left, so she can't feed herself. And I'm talking to my grandma, and she began to tell me, she said, hey, I began to ask myself, God, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? I can't feed myself. How am I going to take care of myself? How am I going to do this, God? And she says, and right there, I put my faith into action. She said those very words. I've never heard my grandmother talk like this. She says, I put my faith into action, son. She goes, and so I went the next day for a follow-up appointment. And they looked at her arm, and they did another x-ray. And they found that the arm had come back together and had literally was healing itself without any intervention except God. It spoke to me so much when she said, I put my faith into action. And then she said, then I went to my uncle's afterwards. And my uncle broke out the Bible, started sharing with me, and I just feel all this encouragement taking place, right? And what happens next is that he begins to just encourage my heart, encourage my spirit, and he's just dropping just like some things that are just like, man. And I asked him, I said, hey, uncle, are you going to publish this? He's like, heck no. I'm going to live it. And right there in that moment, I was like, that's living on the cutting edge. I'm going to live it. This morning, I want to challenge you. Wherever you're at in life, whatever walls you're facing, wherever you feel boxed in, wherever you feel frustrated, wherever you feel hurt or discouraged or left behind, wherever it is, whatever you're facing today, if you need God to sharpen the edge of your life, then allow God to sharpen the edge of your life. If you need God to do something different, you need to see a miracle today, I want to encourage you to trust God for a miracle. If you need to see God rebuild things in your life, then just put your trust in Him. I want to live it. I want to live it. Would you bow your heads with me this morning? Lord, we just come before you right now. God, we take just inventory of our lives, inventory of our hearts. And God, first and foremost, God, forgive us. Forgive us for trying to just find our own way through life. I just pray, God, that we would just begin to give you our trust. Trust out of the frustration. Trust out of the discouragement. Trust out of the defeat. Wherever it is that we need to begin to trust you, God, we just say yes. We cry out to you. Father, I pray right now for a miracle to take place. miracle in lives, a miracle, God, in marriages, in homes, in businesses, in ministries, in dreams, wherever it is, God, that we have a wall in front of us. I just pray, God, for a miracle to take place. If you're here today and you need the edge sharpened, you need the edge of your life sharpened, you're tired of doing it your own way, you're tired of doing things in your own strength, and you need God to be able to strengthen you and give you that edge back, I'm going to ask you to simply come up here. I'm not even going to ask for a raising of hands. I just want you to come up here. And I want you to believe. And we're going to pray with you. And I believe that God is going to do something amazing. If that's you, I just want you to come up here and just begin to just trust God again. If you're here today and you're surrounded by the wall, you're at the place of the wall, and you feel like you just want to give up, or you just feel like, you know, you don't have the answers right now, God is saying, I want to give you the strength. I want to give you the hope. I want to give you the peace. I want to give you the encouragement right now. If that's you, I just want you to come on up. If you're feeling tired today, if you're feeling frustrated, if you're feeling maybe just discouraged about certain things in your life, I'm just going to ask you just to come on up. If you're here today and you say, you know what, I know there's more. I'm not seeing it right now, but I know that there's more. I know that God has a next in mind for my life. I know that there's life beyond the wall that I'm facing right now. I know that there's something beyond what I see right now. If that's you, I'm just going to ask you to come up here this morning. Will we all stand this morning? Come on, just stand up, and let's just begin to acknowledge God. And I just want you to just begin to just call out to God and just trust God. If that's you today, don't be ashamed. Don't be ashamed. You need encouragement from God. You need encouragement by God's Spirit. I just want you to come up. I know there's more. And I'm not going to take very much longer. For the respect of the house. But I just encourage you. Don't give up. Don't give up on your dream. Don't give up where it looks hopeless. Don't give up where you see a surrounding of the wall around you. Don't give up. Don't give up on your children. Don't give up on your marriage. Don't give up the hope. Don't give any ground to the enemy. Don't give up your family. Don't give up. With God, you can do anything. Thank you, God. We just worship you.
Hallelujah. We're going to pray for those that are up here and maybe give some time for others that need some prayer. You know, that was a very powerful word from the Lord. How many received the word of God this morning? Did you receive the word of God this morning? Amen. Hallelujah. You know, I learned this from YouTube, because I would try to cook and I would sharpen my knife. You know how they do it? They just, and my wife would hear it and she would say, oh, my husband thinks he's a chef. And then my children would say, Mom, you hear that sound? I think Dad thinks he thinks he's a chef. And I'm thinking I'm sharpening, right? And I like that sound because it makes me feel like maybe I am a chef, even though I'm not. Well, I learned that doesn't even sharpen the blade. And all this time I'm thinking, I'm cool, because I'm a chef. I'm sharpening this knife. And I learned that you need another set of tools, because just doing this, just keeps the edge straight. It doesn't sharpen it. How many know that when your tools are sharp, your job is easier? A lot easier. And so what happens to all of us is that we're working so hard, we're not going anywhere because our edge is not sharp. Our relationship sometimes becomes dull. Our spirit becomes dull. It's not sharp. We're no longer on the cutting edge of what God is doing in our lives. We're no longer on the cutting edge of His will, His purpose, His plan. And in us, and we find ourselves with our effort, but not going anywhere. It's like, why? The problem is not being involved, because you could be involved, you could be working hard. I know a lot of hardworking people. I know a lot of people who are involved, but still have problems. It's not you being involved or the work you're putting out. It's the edge is not sharp. It's the reason why we're not going here. The edge is not sharp. How many want your spirit to be sharp? Razor sharp. You speak. Things move. It's so sharp. Come on. See, a dull word doesn't do anything, but a sharp word, the sword of the Spirit, speaking God's word powerfully, advances us. God wants to restore dull relationships, dull marriages. He wants to sharpen your relationship with Him. He wants to sharpen your ministry. He wants to sharpen whatever it is. How many of you are ready to pray now? You ready? You want to ask God to make you razor sharp? Say, Lord, there's some places where I'm really dull. You know, the Lord spoke to me years ago and said that the radar system that the church is operating in is so old, it's unable to discern the enemy any longer. And the enemy has come and destroyed my people. We need a new radar system. I said, what? Discernment. God's people, discernment is so dull, they can't see. And we need something sharp. Sharp. Let's pray.